right, so we're going to factor out the greatest common monomial factor. That would be the one term, mono meaning one, that they all have in common. We can start with the numbers, right? What factors do the numbers have in common? What variable factors do they have in common? Just work our way down from there. And the check is always, when we're done, we should be able to distribute what we have and get the original. So what do 9 and 3 have in common?
3.
So it's like that 3. Yeah, we undistribute that 3. What about the m to the 7th, the m squared? Do they have anything in common?
No. Take away 1 and both.
So we can just take out an m?
Yeah.
We can take out m squared. Let's see. If we can, then we should be able to just work our way backwards, multiply this by something to get 9m to the 7th, multiply this by something to get negative 3m squared. Well, if I multiply 3 by 3, I get 9. Following that. M squared times, what would this be? If m squared times this was m to the 7th.
It would be
7
over
5.
So just come out to be m to the 7th. M squared times
5.
M to the 5th. M to the 5th. Right. Let me show you why m squared times m to the 5th is m to the 7th. You got m squared times m to the 5th. What does m squared mean?
M times m.
M times m. What does m to the 5th mean?
M times m 5 times.
You got m times m, and then you have m times m times m times m times m. And what are we doing with these two terms?
We're
multiplying together. So what do we have? M times m times m times m times m times m times m. So what is that? 7 m's being multiplied together. M to the 7th power. Well, you need to get 3 times something to be negative 3. What's that?
Negative 1.
And n squared times something needs to be n squared.
N squared times n?
Just 1. So it's like negative 1 times 1, so it's just negative 1. And if I multiply 3m squared by negative 1, I just get negative 3m squared.
So, I have a quick question.
Yeah?
Is the whole point of this just to try to find like, operating out as far as you can, so like, I don't know how to do this. Because I did it when I did a little quick dishonest. I did like negative 3m times negative 3m 6 plus 1. Could you do that, or are you just trying to find like the easiest?
Sometimes you want to pull out a negative. I mean, that's not a bad idea. Sometimes, but usually the thing that is going to make you do that is if the first term has a negative.
All right.
Otherwise,
okay.
You could or you couldn't. It's up to you, really. But if I did factor out a negative 3m, well, what would be about to have to get a positive 9, so negative 3, just like you said.
Yeah.
This would be m to the 6th. Yeah, m times m to the 6th, m to the 7th. Well, now for negative times something to be a negative, this would be a plus.
Yeah, plus
1m. It would have to be 1m, yeah, or just m. Now, what we have here is you have taken this first expression, you have factored out a negative 3m correctly. But there's, first of all, more that we can factor out, so we can factor out another m. And like I said, we typically would like inside the parentheses here, this first guy to be positive.
Alright,
so if it were negative to start with, that's what I would do. But really, who's to say? If you had negative 3m squared equals negative 3m to the 5th plus 1, then I feel like we got it. Because anything I want that to do, it would do that. Like if I want to use it to solve an equation, then I'm ready to go. So this is just almost there. But if you were to ask like 100 math teachers to factor this, I bet 99 of them would come up with this. Okay, so 22 out of 34, solving an equation. So solving an equation, for us right now is going to look a lot like this with maybe a couple more steps. We're going to factor out a monomial. So let's start with that. And I forgot what number it was already.
34. 9.4.
6h squared, interesting, equals 3h. Okay? So I can't stress this enough. It's really important that one side of the equation be what?
Zero.
Zero. We gotta have zero on one side. Otherwise,
you just are gonna be working in futility.
So we'll subtract 3h from this side. 3h minus 3h is zero. We need a zero on that side. Minus 3h. So 6h squared minus 3h. They're not like terms, so it's not like you can combine them into some new term. So, it's very, very, very important that you have a zero on one side of the equation. Now, to solve this equation, we're using the skill we just practiced in the previous example, factoring out a monomial. Forget about the right side for a second. When I talk about factoring out a monomial, we're just talking about the left side. Because you might think, well, don't have to do the same thing to both sides. But that's only true if I'm changing the left side in some way. But I'm not changing it at all. Let's look at this guy. From here to here, nothing changes. I haven't multiplied by anything. I haven't divided by anything. I haven't added anything to it. I haven't subtracted anything from it. These are exactly equivalent to each other. If I just distribute this 3m squared, I have exactly this. So, since factoring the left side doesn't change what it's worth, I can go ahead and do that. So what do these both have in common? We've got a 3 in common, and an h, leaving us with 2h, equals 0. We factored the left side, factored the 3h out of both of those terms. How do I know that this is correct? How can I check and see that this is correct?
Well, you have to do this. There's a way to do this. I don't know. We explained it last time. But I kind of forgot.
Right. How do I know like this and this are?
You just say 3 times 2h.
Yeah. So we, what's that word? We multiply this 3h by this. Distribute. We distribute the 3h back into the parentheses if we wind up with this. Right? That just serves as our check to confirm that we factored correctly. Distribute the 3h, we get 6h squared minus 3h. We did it right. Okay. Now I'm going to set 3h equal to 0 and 2h minus 1 equal to 0. And I'm going to explain it once again. Why in the world am I doing that? So that if it hasn't clicked with you yet, hopefully it clicks today. I had it click with somebody yesterday in the Algebra 1D class on B-Day. She finally said, okay, now I've been doing this for a while, but I get why I set this whole thing equal to 0. Here's the reason why. We will put a blank page here. 3h times 2h minus 1. It's not as if we haven't solved equations similar to this before. If it was on the quiz that we just took. It uses this thing called the zero product property. First, you have to see this as one thing, right? I've underlined it, one of the things. I'm going to underline a second thing. Here's the second thing. Right? And those two things are being multiplied together. You all get that? So I have this big, thick underline here under the one term, and I put a big, thick underline under that other expression over there that's inside the parentheses, and that is two things. Like, for instance, if I were to just take 3h times 2h minus 1, just throw a number in there for h, just who cares what it is, let's say 5, okay? All right, well, this guy here is, right, 3 times 5. This guy would be 2 times 5 minus 1. This turns out to be two numbers. The number 15 times, this is 10 minus 1, that's 9. Because two things being multiplied together, 15 times 9. 15 times 9. But 15 times 9 isn't what I want it to be. What do I want that to come out to be?
0.
I want it to come out to be 0. So, somehow, whatever number I plug in for h, it needs to come out so that then one of them is 0, exactly. That either this thing is 0,
could
be all goose egg here.
If you do negative 2.
Oh, well, we can try it, but that's not going to make the parentheses go to 0. But finding what makes parentheses go to 0 is not too hard a thing. But what we're concentrating on here is that either this big parentheses comes out to be a 0 times whatever the heck this is, it doesn't even matter. That'll make it come out to be 0 like I want. Or this comes out to be 0. Not 15. Right? This comes out to be 0. And then whatever this thing is, whether it be 9 or 12 or 15, or it doesn't matter, it's going to get multiplied by this 0 and come out to be 0. So we can see how this needs to be 0, this needs to be 0, and that's why I've done what I've done. This needs to be equal to 0, or this entire parenthesis here needs to be equal to 0.
So, in a way, isn't it basically just saying h equals 0, which is more complicated because I mean, if you multiply by 3 by 0, though, it's something really
good. Okay, so
that's
in
what
this,
I mean by that.
In this one, yes. In this one, this one would come out to be h is 0. I think we could do the silly step that we don't really need to, because it's obvious here that h is 0. Obviously, h has to be 0. The other option would be that 3 is equal to 0. That's ridiculous. 3 is not 0. 3 is 3. So, h has to be 0. For this one, h isn't going to be 0. H is going to be whatever it takes to make this whole thing be 0.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, we'll add 1 to both sides. Just solve it simple equation here. You got 2h equals 1. Well, of course, 2h has to be equal to 1 because 1 minus 1 is having a 0. Well, how will 2 times h be 1? Well, we'll divide by 2. And if h is 1 half, if h is 1 half, then 2 times 1 half is 1, and 1 minus 1 is 0. So h has to be 1. So there's why this, right, we always set the left thing equal to 0, the right thing equal to 0, because they're being multiplied together. If they were being added together, like I can't say this is 0 and this is 0. It's not a thing that I know for sure. But I do know if I multiply two numbers together and get 0, that or that has to be 0. We're going to continue that today.
Yeah.
So we're going to... There's a fairly simple factoring problem where we just factor out a 3h for both things. But then we'll have to factor a longer expression. So let's do that. Let's do that factoring again. Another... example of that, number 15. And 9.5. There it is. P squared plus 20p plus 64. Let's start off by stating some obvious things. This polynomial must have come from multiplying two parentheses together. The beginning of each of these parentheses must have been a p. They must have both had just p at the beginning of the parentheses. Because I have p squared. Okay, in case you're not understanding that, let's just make an arbitrary example. So we're just making it up right now. So we start with x plus 5 times x plus 7. Who can multiply those two together for us?
That's
the whole thing.
Oh, the whole thing. So x.
How do you know x squared?
Because two x's.
Right. You're going to take the x times the x. You get x squared.
And this one means you have 7.
Okay, x times 7, distribute that x to that 7, we get x plus, or sorry, plus 7x.
And then 5x.
Distribute the 5 now, we got 5x.
Now we have 35.
And 5 times 7, that's 35. If we are very good, fluent, and skilled, and have no problems really multiplying two parentheses like this, It's not too big of a leap to go backwards. Because here's two key things right off the bat. You know that x squared comes from x times x, right? Just real briefly, just as a kind of an aside, taking a break from this problem for a second, what if I had 2x plus 7 times x minus 4? Forget about everything else. Are we going to wind up with an x squared term, a term with x squared in it?
Yep.
What will it be? What will it look like? What x
squared? 2x
squared. 2x times x. That's the only way that you get x squared from this problem, is if you take the x times the x. Are there going to be other x squares to add to that or subtract from that? Not in this problem. In other problems, sure. But this one? No. You know there's going to be like 2x squared. And if I had this to start with, well, then I can imagine the parentheses that it came from, the product would have a 2x in one of the parentheses and an x in the other, because I know that when I multiply, I got 2x squared. So, for the same reason, in the problem we're working on, clearly, the x squared came right from the x times the x. So I know that that part of the parentheses looks like that, an x times an x. And at the very end, where did the 35 come from?
5 times 7.
Just 5 times 7. Stay with me.
Sorry.
We know the 5 times the 7 gives the 35, just the number, right? The lone constant term. And that's nice because it's just that number times that number. So if I'm trying to fill in these blanks, I know that whatever those two numbers are multiplied together to make 35. And here in the middle, that's what brings it all together. I know the x squared comes from x times x. I know the 35 comes from 5 times 7. The middle part,
where does that come from?
That's what takes a little bit of practice to build up that skill, a little trial and error sometimes. Okay. So if we started with x squared plus 12x plus 35, already know from everything we just talked about that this x squared must have come from x times x, and 35 must come from blank times blank. Right? Well, 7 5 is a 3. Clearly, the only other option is 35 times 1. And, well, that could be it, but I don't think so. So I guess my 7 and my 5 from the 35, and then I just multiply it out and see if it works. Did it work? The test of whether or not it works is, did I get 12x? Middle term. So let's try it with the one we're working on now. We're working on p squared plus 20p plus 64. Look, we know the p squared comes from p times p. Mm-hmm. Gotta be. When I multiply these together, that's the only way p squared is going to come out of this thing. Okay, well, I know that 64 comes from what? I don't know the numbers, but I do know that they're
eight.
It's going to come from doing what? Multiplying.
8 times 8 is 64. So
we know it's this guy times this guy.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we have to figure out which two numbers, which are lots of combinations. Several combinations that multiply to 64. Several combinations multiply to 64. 8 and 8. Positive 8 and positive 8. Is that right?
Yeah.
Why do you know that?
Because it doesn't equal 20.
What doesn't equal 20?
8 plus 8.
So you're not even really multiplying it out. You're just like, well, I know that's going to be an 8p. That's going to make an 8p.
Yeah.
And so 8 plus 8, is it 20? No, it's 16.
Well.
So 8 and 8, that's out. Right? That's out.
It was
close. We almost had it. So what is another combination of two numbers that multiply to 64? I would 64 and 1.
No.
64p plus 1p would be 65p. I don't know. That's out. Okay? What else? 2? 2 and 32?
Why not?
Why not?
Because it doesn't equal 20.
What does it equal?
36, or
34. 34, we get 34p in the middle term. It's out, 2 and 32 is out. How about 4? 16, 4 times 16 is 64.
Yeah. And also
and 16 plus 4,
yeah.
Right? 16p plus 4p. You got to really think of it. You don't want to do it too much shortcutting to the point that you forget what, why in the world it even works.
Okay.
It works because if we were to multiply these together, we get a p squared.
Mm-hmm.
On the very end, we get a 64, clearly. In the middle, we get a 16p plus 4p. 16p plus 4p is 20p. And that's exactly what we want. So p plus 4 times p plus 16, that must be it. That must be the one. Let's try another one, because it seems like it would help you to have a little more practice. And we definitely need to know this well before we move on. So, let's see, let's pick a nice example. Let's try x squared minus 10x plus 16.
Ah.
16. We know that this is the product of two parentheses.
Sorry, such a huge interruption.
Save. So this will get trickier as the weeks go on, but this is pretty simple. We can see that the x squared is going to have to come from x times x, right? So we can fill in some blanks. That's obvious. Like that has got to be x times x. We also can jump to the end and see the 16 clearly has to be the result of multiplying this by this. And this part's a little more tricky, a little more mysterious. Gotta try this and try that and see if it works out based on that middle term, negative 10x. Like, so here's an example. 16. 4 times 4, right? 4. So I tried it, and I get x squared, and of course I get 16. That's locked down. There's no way I'm not going to get those two things, because I made it be that way. But does it work out for the rest of the problem? Well, I try it, and I get 4x plus 4x. That's wrong on so many levels. It's positive, and it's 8. Okay, so that's definitely not going to work. But so, for one thing, this is positive. How, what am I supposed to do about the fact that this is negative? Make them both negative. We can start to catch those things before we even start making guesses. Right? As we do more of these, we practice more and more. We notice this is positive, so it's something times something, like either negative times negative or positive times positive. But then we add up to a negative, so it must be negative times negative. Right? We make those connections just based on our experience. So it must be a negative thing times a negative thing. So that's like, I could kind of etch that in stone. There's definitely going to be two negatives. So I know, like as I multiply it out, it's going to start to look like this, x squared minus something, plus 16. I know all that stuff for sure. So I need two somethings that obviously multiply to 16, but then when I put them here and here, they add up to negative 10. So well, it's not negative 4, negative 4, I'll bet that gave me an 8. It's just going to be negative 8. You know, it's 16 and 1, it's not. So maybe it's 8 and 2, negative 8, negative 2. So x squared, positive 16, clearly, negative 8 times negative 2 gives me the positive 16. We get a negative 2x, negative 8x, those add together to negative 10x. All right. Let's do one more. See if everybody can come up with it without copying or arguing this time.
Thank God.
Especially with Branson.
Right?
Seriously.
You
know,
no.
Yeah, the guy in front.
the guy in front. Exactly, the guy in front.
You can be the sneakiest out of all of them.
I meant
you. You have to turn around 180 degrees.
Right.
So right now, things we know, things we don't quite know. We do know that each parenthesis must have just a single x in it because x times x is going to give us the x squared.
Yes.
All right. Let's see, we're multiplying these two numbers together and getting 72, positive 72. We're also adding them together and getting a negative 17. The only way to get a positive when you multiply is positive times positive, or negative times negative. So it's definitely going to be negative times negative, right? Because we're going to add together to make a negative number, negative 17. So those are the things that, like, we can write that in pen and know that we're never going to have to fix that mistake because there's no mistake so far. know x times x is x squared, we know negative times negative is positive, and it adds together to make negative. It's just a matter of which two numbers that multiply to 72, when they both have a negative, also add up to negative 17. You know, we've got 24 and 3, that's not going to work. That adds up to negative 27. We can just try a bunch of different combinations until we find, what? 8 times 9. Now, if you just keep throwing things in and then multiply to 72, you're still not quite getting that all you need to do is figure out what multiplies to 72 and adds to negative 17. Multiplies while also adding to negative 17. All you have to do, multiply it out, see what happens. X times x is x squared. X times negative 9, negative 9x. Negative 8 times x, negative 8x. Negative 8 times negative 9, positive 72. X squared, negative 9x minus 8x is negative 17x. 72. We did it. So our answer, though, a lot of times people will write this and then double check and then give me this as their answer. That was the question. So I don't need to know that. I need to know this. That is the factor form of x squared minus 17x plus 72. How are we feeling? A little better?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Stuff. Good. Okay, let's use this example to just springboard into today, okay?
Huh?
Because the kind of thing we're going to do today, it's exactly like what we've been doing, except we're going to use the skill to solve equations in the same way that we solve equations from the homework that's due today. We're going to factor, making sure the other side is zero, so we factor it just like we just factored it a second ago. X minus 8, x minus 9, 0. And right here, we have, like, if you look on this quiz that I just handed back recently, it has exactly this. Step number 2 is just where you start in the quiz. You have two factors multiplied by each other equals 0. So either this guy is the 0, this left parenthesis is the 0, or this right parenthesis is 0. One of them has to be 0, because if neither of them was 0, there's no way you're going to multiply them together and get 0. It's not going to happen. So we just set that up. Or early on with these easy equations, of course, you can see that x would have to be, in order for this to be 0, what would x have to be?
Eight.
And for this parenthesis to be 0, what would x have to be? If I were going to be really meticulous and proper about solving this equation, I would say, well, x minus 8 has to be 0, so add 8 to both sides and x is 8. Or x minus 9 has to be 0, add 8 to, or add 9 to both sides and x is 9. And we're going to want to get in the habit, because soon enough we're going to have factors like 3x plus 14, right? And then we're going to want to figure out what is x that is not as obvious. So the idea of taking each factor and setting it equal to 0 is a really good habit. Really good habit. Because by the time the equations get more complicated, you're just used to doing it anyway. Okay? And setting it equal to 0 and having that simple equation to solve is really handy. So let's try another one and see how you guys do. And then we'll just throw a little curveball at you and then talk about some vocab. So let's say x squared plus 3x minus 18 equals 0. Have to worry about factoring it, and then worry about solving the equation. So how does it factor?
X. Oh, sorry. Minus 3.
X minus 3.
Plus 6.
X plus 6.
Will it matter if you just have those first?
X plus 6 and x minus 3? It won't matter, because this way I'll get x squared plus 6, x minus 3, x minus 18, and well, that would combine to 3x. The other way, I would have x squared minus 3x plus 6x minus 18, which these would still add together to make positive 3x. Right, so once again, the whole explanation of the zero product property, what we have, is one expression times another expression equals zero. Okay. So either this guy here is a zero, and you multiply by whatever this is, it doesn't matter, it comes out to be zero. So x minus 3 could be zero. Or just kind of switch roles. This thing, this right thing could be the zero, and this other thing could be whatever, it doesn't matter what it is, because whatever it is, times zero will still be zero. So x plus 6 could be zero. Okay, and not only that, that's the only two possibilities. If one of these isn't zero, then it'll never come out to be equal to zero, because we're multiplying these two things together. So if this were not a zero, like this was a 1, and this was not a zero, say it was a 2, 1 times 2 is 2. So we kind of tell the left parentheses, hey, you're gonna be zero right now. And what would it take to make you a zero? Well, it would take x being 3. We have to read both sides to see that x would have to be 3. And then we say to the right parentheses, okay, now you play the part of being zero. X plus 6, you're zero now. What would x have to be? We subtract 6 from both sides, x would be negative 6. There we go. Those are the two solutions, 3. So we factor it, set each factor equal to 0, solve for x. Make sense?
Yep.
All right. Then, let's get some homework on. So if you get an equation like x squared plus 5x plus 9 equals 3, and now we have a bit of an issue. What's the problem here? Yeah, so we need one of them. What's that?
We need one of them zero.
Yeah, we need one side or the other to be zero. It's not ready for that. Even if I could factor this, even if just by sheer brute force I managed to get this factored, it wouldn't really help because it's equal to 3. There's nothing I can say about two numbers that multiply together and make 3. So how do I get the right side to be 0? Question.
The right side to be 0,
you
carry it over to the
this side?
Left. Just subtract 3 from both sides.
Well, minus 9 would make this 0 and this negative 6, but I want this side to be 0.
Oh, that side to be 0.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Subtract 3 from both sides?
Yeah. Subtract 3. Same idea, but we want to get rid of that.
I thought you meant 9.
So x squared plus 5x plus 6 equals 0, showing you quickly this factors as x plus 2 times x plus 3. X is negative 2, and x is negative 3.
It's so simple.
And then we're done right there, that's it.
So that's the problem not set up all the way, and this other thing is just a like a vocab thing. So like, we could make this be, let's take this part out and erase all this stuff here.
Could you just click clear page? Yeah.
But I wanted that part.
Oh.
Okay. So now let's say this in a slightly different context. Let's say we have a function, f of x equals x squared plus 5x plus 6, or, you know, this is the same as saying y equals. F of x equals x squared plus 5x plus 6. So it might ask you to find the zeros of this function. So like I said, it's just a vocab. All this means is, like, what would I have to plug in for x? What do I have to plug in for x so that this whole thing comes out to be 0? If I want this whole thing to come out to be 0, let's just set that up. I want this whole thing, and y value is what I want. The y value of 0 is what I want. So what do we have here? We have an equation that we just solved a second ago. We factored it as x plus 2 times x plus 3, and x plus negative 2, x plus negative 3, we found it. Notice x being 0 is not going to work. 0 plus 0 plus 6 will give me 6. So 0 plus. So find the zeros of the function. That's like the phrase that I want to have stayed in your head. Find the zeros means the y value comes out to be zero. What was the x value? Well, you're just right back to solving the equations that we've solved like four or five of today. Okay. So there we go. So one of the things that I've